Romance in regular movies.
Annoying.
Sad.
Dramatic.
They always throw in a love interest we don't care about.
There's always a love triangle between two boring guys.
For romantic comedies,
inject that into my freaking veins.
Adam Sandler and Drew Barrymore are having relationship problems.
You know what I'm having relationship problems.
Sorry, Stacy. It's over.
The romantic comedy is one of my favorite genres. Straight up. I'm not, like, for real. I guess you could say, not like other guys. There's just something about seeing regular, ordinary people going through regular, ordinary things, finding a love that's not regular or ordinary. In the grand scheme of things, the stakes are so low. There's no bomb that's gonna go off or a planet that's gonna be destroyed. But can Heath Ledger win over this punk girl who hates life?
I need to know.
I swear these smaller stakes have me more invested. The world's blowing up. Blow it up, dude. I don't care. We've seen that in how many movies?
Wait, Sandra Bullock and Ryan Reynolds can work through their issues?
You know what? We can work through our issues.
Stacy, we're back on.
I made a video about the death of comedy movies, and I was thinking about romantic comedies because I feel like they died out in a completely different way for different reasons. They're not extinct or anything, but the standard romantic comedy from the 1990s and 2000s is pretty much done. Netflix is the lifeline to this entire genre right now.
Its thread is hanging by a thread.
I want to talk about what the heck happened to them
and why we need them.
In this video, you already know what it is, man. I don't even gotta say it. Romantic comedies were so huge in the 80s and 90s. They were top grossing movies. They made stars out of people like Julia Roberts, Meg Ryan, Shrek the Ogre. They were getting nominated for and even winning Oscars for Best Picture. There's a guilty pleasure feeling to them. I know I'm not watching the greatest friggin' thing cinema has to offer, okay? But it's like, I know what's gonna happen, and yet I still want to see it happen. There's a girl from a small town and a guy from a big city, or the other way around. There's a meet cute. They meet each other in an interesting and quirky way. They might not even like each other at the beginning. In fact, it's better if they hate each other. They get together despite impossible odds. And the end of the second act, there has to be a big fight. And then they break up. Oh, so sad. Oh, how can I live without this person? And then they realize they can't. And then there's a confession of love at a New Year's Eve party or an airport
or outside with a boombox.
And then they get back together for realsies this time. But the thing is, this formula was basically perfected in like 1989 with When Harry Met Sally. So if people have been seeing the same thing since, it's bound to get old eventually. I honestly think the breaking point was when there was that movie with Natalie Portman and Ashton Kutcher, and then that same year there was another movie with Mila Kunis and Justin Timberlake, and they had the same exact story. It was like the same movie in the same year. That's when I was like, okay, was this an accident? Did you guys do this by accident? What's going on here? That being said, on YouTube this week, the killing of the romantic comedy by Curtis Connor. The way we watch movies has kind of shifted recently. Most people don't go to the movies anymore unless they're must-see movies. The movies you have to watch opening weekend because you have to know what everybody is talking about. You don't want to get spoiled, but romantic comedies are never really must-see movies anymore because you know what you're gonna see. Do I really need to see Pretty Woman? What's the twist? She's not pretty? I doubt that. Romantic comedies have been parodied to the point where no one can take this genre seriously anymore.
So, who's the guy?
Why do you think there's always a guy, Thor?
Honey, you're putting ketchup on your cereal.
But maybe they don't have to be taken seriously. That's the whole point of the genre. It's like they take place in an alternate universe. We watch movies to escape. This is like the prime form of escapism. But there were just a ton of bad romantic comedies that made you wish love never existed. Every single Christmas movie has the same poster. You can only see a white man and a white woman get together against all odds so many times. The odds are in your favor, okay? I'm just kidding. Any minority role was basically designated to being the funny best friend. Black guy? Gay guy? Asian woman? You make a great best friend to this white woman who's really got something to complain about. To you! She's having a hard time, okay? So if you could listen and maybe crack a few jokes every now and then for the audience. There's always a strong businesswoman and a guy has to wear her down or something. Love is a universal topic and a universal language, but Hollywood was stuck telling the same story over and over. Romance in stories has been around before movies even existed. It should never be dead. It should never run out of ideas, but these movies just got stuck in the same tropes. But there were attempts to subvert the usual rom-com ideas. If I had to put the genre into three categories, it would be the classics, you know, the golden age, the subversions, and then more of like modern day. The classics are the ones where it's like, you know, you have to marry somebody that you don't want to marry. You want to marry somebody else. Anything with a bet.
Anything with a bet is the best.
Can this guy get this girl to go out with him for $20? Can men and women be friends? Can these two pretend to be married so Sandra Bullock doesn't get deported?
Can she lose the guy in 10 days?
Anything with a bet or a bribe, that's a great way to start a relationship.
Believe me, I know.
My last relationship started over a friendly game of gambling myself into unrecoverable debt. These are always considered chick flick movies, but I feel like most of them are made with the guys in mind. Like, most of these movies are schlubby average guy wins over beautiful woman.
How's that a young girl's fantasy?
That's my life. You think a 14-year-old girl is like, oh, I want a dreamy guy like Vince Vaughn?
No.
Vince Vaughn in the real world with Jennifer Aniston?
Please.
You're telling me Nick Miller got Zooey Deschanel and Megan Fox in the same series?
Well, I believe you.
Nick Miller is goated. Seeing two conventionally attractive people together is not funny. I'm sorry. Save that for the regular Hallmark romance movie. All the stories are about women who can't live, who don't feel complete without a man. And I feel like that's why a lot of these movies did begin to die. Between declining ticket sales and worn out gender stereotypes, there was nothing really new for the romantic comedy to tell us. Also, if we're being honest, today's generation doesn't really relate to some of the older romantic comedies. But I also don't want to see a 50-year-old movie executive sign off on a movie about freaking Tinder or something. Where's the movie about the guy who got ghosted so many times that he becomes a ghost himself? Or he ghosts so many girls that he becomes a ghost and now he has to find love in the afterlife? And it's called Ghosted.
Bro, hold on.
I literally just made that off the top of my head, and that sounds like a box office smash from 2005. If Netflix steals that, you know it was me, because it was so dumb, no one else would have done it. Around the late 2000s, early 2010s, you'd see more romantic comedies play out differently than what we're used to. The stories about the woman falling in love with herself, or about how friendship is real love. I Love You Man is a perfect example of like two of these put together. Or the biggest subversion of the rom-com trope. The couple doesn't get together in the end. Now there's a twist for the ages, because it's like real life. Let's take the genre that's supposed to make us escape from real life and make it more like the one we don't want to live in. At the time, honestly, this is appreciated. I like seeing that, because I was like, dude, whoa, they don't get together. You know what? That's interesting. But now I'm at the point where I'm like, all right, I get it. They don't get together, all right? Give me the happy ending. I need the happy ending, bro. Give me my happiness. I need the serotonin. I came here to see y'all do what I can't. Okay, movies like 500 Days of Summer, the most misunderstood movie of all time, about a guy idealizing his girlfriend and not getting her in the end because he doesn't deserve her, even if he's the lead in a romantic comedy, and yet people see Summer as the villain, mostly by people that were probably hurt in their own lives. It's time to move on, bud. Around this time, we saw a ton of romantic comedies that were a deconstruction of romantic comedies, and this brings us to modern romantic comedies, where there are like five of. In 2017, there were literally zero romantic comedies put out in theaters compared to a couple years before when there were way more. But Netflix, like I said, basically revived this entire genre. And their romantic comedies have evolved to fit the times a little bit. Only thing that's been staying the same is this guy, bro. Noah Centineo. They put this man in every movie. If you got a romantic comedy on Netflix, this guy is in it. This man just got casted as MLK in the next biopic. They actually started adding him to the background of episodes of The Office. Bro, get me in there, man. Do I not look like a young strapping lad that would freaking sweep a woman off her feet I can't even say it without not being confident in myself. To all the boys I loved before, I couldn't really get through the movie, but it was pretty cool to see a romantic comedy with an Asian woman as the comedic lead. Same with Always Be My Maybe and Crazy Rich Asians. Netflix saw there was an audience for this kind of content. For people who are starving for new romantic comedies, and people who are starving for media with casts that actually look like them. We had movies in the past like Coming to America and Hitch with diverse casts, but these were like me making YouTube videos for the first 8 years of my career on here. It didn't happen often. Movies like The Big Sick with Kumail Nanjiani and Love, Simon showed that there's plenty more stories to tell in this genre that aren't really mainstream.
So, 9/11. I've always wanted to have a conversation with people.
You've never talked to people about 9/11?
And it seems like it's working, and I'm not the only person that misses romantic comedies, because these are freaking popping off. They just made To All the Boys I've Loved Before 3, and you're telling me we can't get a Nacho Libre 2? You're telling me we couldn't get 11 Things I Hate About You? How many boys did she love before? So the romantic comedy isn't really dead right now, but at one point it was, and it had to find a way to evolve. These stories have always been criticized for being unrealistic. Can we just be in a world for a little bit where everything works out? There's a quote by Mindy Kaling where she called it a subgenre of sci-fi, which I love. Like, you don't go into a romantic comedy and expect like that to be reality. Like, Come on, word of advice in general from someone who shouldn't give relationship advice. If you look to movies or TV or social media to know what you want out of a relationship or how you should be treated or what you should need to do, you're gonna go crazy. That's my Valentine's Day advice to all you single kings and queens out there. We're out here, we are doing us. What about you? What's your favorite romantic comedy of all time? Do you hate romantic comedies and you're glad that they're dead? Let me know in the comments down below. Over on Twitch, Zed Live is going freaking strong, baby. Come on. We got the legend himself, Noel Miller, coming onto the show later this week. If you're watching this video right now, when it's uploaded, I'm freaking live right now, dude. We're gonna be playing music, hanging out, talking relationship advice, maybe playing Little Nightmares too, cause relationships are a bloody little nightmare all day, mate. Please, I'm alone today, so come hang out with me. Here's my favorite clip from last week's stream.
Had to leave the stream to watch that new Cody Ko. So you left me for a white man, is what you're trying to say. You left me for a white man during what? What time is it right now? Black History Month? You left me for a white man during Black History Month? Ban them! Ban them! Instant ban! Mods, get them!
It's the Nathan Zed and Z, Nathan Nolan, the Remy Ratatouille of YouTube, the Troy Bolton of Not Folded, with another classic. I don't even want to say it, I was delivered. Out here playing games, he was out here with a lane. I can play the side, nigga, real easy, but I'm too.